A time to thank and praise God. Let's talk to God together. Dear Father, we thank you for all the gifts you freely give us each day. We thank you for life and health and safety, for power to work and time to rest. And we thank you for all that is beautiful in this world and in our lives. But above all, we praise you for our Saviour, Jesus Christ, for his death and resurrection, for the gift of your Spirit, and for the hope of sharing in your glory. This morning, please fill our hearts with your grace and peace. We pray this in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Mercy in your eyes. Good morning, everyone. Don't make me cry. We're looking at two words today from the Bible talk, and the first word is bold. Being bold is not the same as being bald. If you are bald, then you have no hair on your head like the man in the picture. However, if someone is described as being bold, then they are not afraid to try something new. They are not frightened of danger. They are not afraid to be different from other people. They are very brave. Other words with a similar meaning include fearless, daring, and courageous. In the first example, reporter and author Mr. Robert Jobson says that Prince Philip was a bold and witty person who was not afraid to offend people. Mr. Jobson says that Prince Philip was most proud of starting the Duke of Edinburgh's award, which has inspired young people from all over the world to become the best person they can be through action and experience. In the second example, Australian tech company Atlassian has released plans for its new headquarters in Sydney. Located near Central Station, the design for the 40-story building is bold and will include a mix of timber, glass, and steel, and will be over 180 metres tall when completed in 2025. Now, the next word is partner or partnership. If two or more people do something together, we call them partners. Partners work together to achieve a common goal. They cooperate and help each other. They have a joint interest. People can be partners in almost any activity, including business, sport, and personal relationship, for example, husband and wife, and even dancing. A partnership is where there is an agreement between people to work together. In the first example, John Lennon and Paul McCartney enjoyed one of the most successful partnerships in music history. Together as the Beatles, with two others, they recorded over 200 songs, produced 18 studio albums, and sold over 600 million records. In the second example, Virgin Airlines Australia has signed a new two-year partnership deal with Alliance Regional Airlines. The new agreement will mean that Virgin will now be able to provide flights to 41 regional domestic routes within Australia, including Sydney-Canberra, which they suspended during COVID. Now, I want you to have a discussion with the people around you. Can you identify these famous partnerships? So I'm going to show you the six pictures, and then I'll let you discuss it for 2 minutes. So some famous partnerships. See if you know who they are and discuss them, and I'll stop you after 2 minutes. So the words for today were bold and partner or partnership. Thank you.
A time to hear and think about God's word. Before we hear God's word, let's pray. Heavenly Father, give us humility to receive your word. Give us understanding to know what it means, and give us the desire and the ability to do what you say. We ask all of this through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Paul and Timothy, servants of Christ Jesus, to all God's holy people in Christ Jesus at Philippi, together with the overseers and deacons, grace and peace to you from God, our Father, and the Lord Jesus Christ. I thank my God every time I remember you. In all my prayers for all of you. I always pray with joy because of your partnership in the gospel from the first day until now. Being confident of this, that he who began a good work in you will carry it on to completion until the day of Christ Jesus. It is right for me to feel this way about all of you, since I have you in my heart, and whether I am in chains or defending and confirming the gospel. All of you share in God's grace with me. God can testify how I long for all of you with the affection of Christ Jesus. And this is my prayer, that your love may abound more and more in knowledge and depth of insight, so that you may be able to discern what's the best and may be pure and blameless for the day of Christ, filled with the fruit of righteousness that comes through Jesus Christ to the glory and praise of God. Now I want you to know, brothers and sisters, that what has happened to me has actually served to advance the gospel. As a result, it has become clear throughout the whole palace, God, and to everyone else that I am in chains for Christ. And because of my chains, most of the brothers and sisters have become confident in the Lord and dare of all the more to proclaim the gospel without fear. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks to be God.
Well, it is wonderful to be with you and to be able to think together with you about what God is saying to us this morning. As we, I guess, look forward to Mikey and Lil's time with their kids overseas. We've been thinking a lot about them as a family, as they prepare to go. And I want us to pause a little bit now and think, what does it mean for those of us who don't go? How can we love and support them well? They're a wonderful family. We want to see them thrive, we want to see them go well while they are overseas. But what can we do? I mean, they're the ones who are going. Well, I think that in Paul's letter to the Philippians that we just had the beginning read to us, we see there some wonderful truths about our role as those who send and support and partner with those who go. We'll see that we are all together partners in the gospel. But let me pray, if I might. Heavenly Father, we thank you that you are the Lord of all nations. We thank you that you have given us life and hope, that you have saved us through Jesus, our Lord. And we thank you for the privilege of being a part of seeing this message of life and hope go to the ends of the earth. Please help us to know how to serve that goal. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. There are many things in life that are just best left to the experts. Many years ago, my first car was a 1976 Toyota Corona. Now, some people say, no, a Corona is a beer. It's like, no, it was a car back in 1976. And this car was very simple. So my father and I could work on this car. We could adjust the timing, we could change the parts and make it run better. But today, I can't do anything on my car because the cars are so different now. They have so much electronics. When I open the bonnet, it looks like a computer, not an engine. So I have to take my car to the experts, let the experts do it, and pay them for the privilege. There are lots of things in life that are like that. We get the experts to do it. So if your computer breaks, you take to the experts. If you crack the screen on your phone, most of us take it to the experts, get them to fix it. If you need surgery on your brain, you take it to the experts. But is mission like that? Is mission something that we leave to the experts? Because Mikey and Lil are experts. They've already spent some time overseas. They've spent lots of time studying the Bible. They've had lots of practice sharing the gospel with other people. Now they're all ready to pack up and go again. They're the experts. Do we just leave it to them? Well, no. That's not the picture of mission that we get in the Bible. We see that people are gifted differently and shaped differently and used differently, but we are all working together to see God's mission fulfilled. We all have a part to play. And that is very clear in Paul's letter to the Philippians. This letter that we had the introduction read is really a letter from a missionary to a church that sent him. It's just like a letter that Mikey and Lil will send, won't you, Mikey and Lil? Yes. Back to this church to tell us how they're going, to give us an update, to share things that we can be praying for. That's what this letter is, the letter to the Philippians. And Paul is focusing in this letter on the Philippians' role in the work that he is doing. And we know that that is a central point of the letter because it's right there at the very beginning. If we just have the first slide. In verse 3 of chapter 1, Paul says, "I thank my God every time I remember you. In all of my prayers for all of you, I always pray with joy." Why? Because of your partnership in the gospel from the first day until now. Why is Paul thankful to God? Why does Paul pray with joy? It's because the Philippians are partnering with him in the gospel. Now, when he says the gospel here, he means the work of sharing the gospel, speaking to people about Jesus, helping people to know the good news that Jesus has provided a way to be saved. Paul is telling people this gospel message, this good news, and he's excited because the Philippians are active partners with him. They're working with him to see that happen. Paul is the one who's out there. He's the one who's traveling. He's the one who's starting new churches. He's the one who's speaking to people about Jesus. But he sees the believers at Philippi as partners in that task. See, God's mission is not just for the experts. In many ways, when Mikey and Lil go, those of us who are praying for them and supporting them are just as much a part of the ministry as they are. We are all partners together in this task of God's mission. That's how Paul views it, that's how God views it, and that's how we need to view it. We are all partners in the task. It's a little bit like if you have heart surgery. Has anybody had heart surgery here? Anybody? No? There's always one. Praise the Lord. Now, when you have heart surgery, you could say, "Dr. Chang did my surgery." Dr. Chang is the surgeon who you went and talked to beforehand. But if you were actually there when the surgery happened, you would see that there are lots of people. There's Dr. Chang, and then there's a surgical assistant, and then there's an anaesthetist, and then there's some nurses, and there's all sorts of people there. In one sense, Dr. Chang does the surgery, but really everybody is partners in the surgery. They're all involved in the task. That's what mission is like. We all have different roles, but we are all partners in the task. So how? How do we express this partnership? Well, in Paul's letter to the Philippians, we see four different ways that this partnership is expressed. And I just want to speak about these briefly. Firstly, we see that the Philippians partner by speaking the gospel message. We all partner as we all speak about Jesus. They partner through prayer, through practical support, and through financial support. So speaking the message, prayer, practical support, financial support. Let's look at each of these. Can we go to the next slide, please? Speaking the message. All of us can speak the message about Jesus. Paul was in jail when he wrote this letter, but he says this about his time in jail, in chains. He says, because of my chains, most of the brothers and sisters have become confident in the Lord and dare all the more to proclaim the gospel without fear. Paul is not the only one who proclaims the gospel. All of God's people speak this message of Jesus, sharing this truth about what Jesus has done. And as we see Mikey and Lil go overseas, one of the ways that we join in the work that they are doing is we also take every opportunity to share about Jesus, because it's a message that everybody needs to hear. See, people were inspired because they saw Paul is even willing to go to prison because this message is so important. In the same way, when we see Mikey and Lil and their kids living in Korea, wrestling with language and learning and all the challenge that they'll have, it would be a reminder to us that's how important Jesus is. We all need to be a part of seeing this message shared. Now, some people are very good at speaking about Jesus. Some of us find it more difficult. But if you know Jesus, then you can speak about him. We all can be a part of this mission by speaking about Jesus. Just like the heart surgeon. The heart surgeon can tell you about how to look after your heart, but so can the anaesthetist. So can the assistant. So can the nurses. We can all be involved in helping people have healthy hearts. We have an even better way to have a healthy heart. We can tell people about Jesus. So let Mikey and Lil's experience encourage you to be talking to your friends and neighbours, to the people in Campsie, about Jesus. Let it be an encouragement to take every opportunity you have, because that's the first way that we partner in the gospel. The second way is through prayer. Can we have the next slide, please? A little bit further in chapter 1, Paul says, yes, I will continue to rejoice, for I know that through your prayers and the help given by the Spirit of Jesus Christ, what has happened to me will turn out for my deliverance. Paul was in prison. He was experiencing many challenges. But he knew the Philippians were praying for him. And he knew that their prayers made a difference. No matter where we are, speaking to people about Jesus is a challenge. It's hard. It's a spiritual battle. And so prayer is needed. And as we pray for Mikey and Lil, it's as if we are standing right with them. That's how Paul talks about it in another letter in Romans. He says, join me in my struggle by praying. It is a struggle. But as we pray, we join Mikey and Lil in their work. And notice what Paul says. He says, I know that through your prayers and the help given by the Spirit of Jesus Christ, this will turn out for my deliverance. See, when we pray, we're not just partnering with Mikey and Lil. We're actually partnering with God's Spirit. We are joining in with what God is doing, joining God's work. And we can be confident that our prayers will make a difference. We are involved in the ministry. So let me encourage you to think, to plan about how are you going to keep praying for Mikey and Lil. Maybe you'll put their picture on your fridge. Maybe you'll put a note in your Bible. Maybe you'll write it on your diary every Tuesday morning, pray for Mikey and Lil. Because when you pray, you partner, you join them. It's like you're there. And then let me encourage you to send them a little note and say, I prayed for you this morning. Because there's nothing more encouraging than knowing that people are with you in the task. So that's another way we partner. We partner by speaking. We partner by praying. The third way we partner, next slide please, is through practical support. Now we see that there was practical support from the Philippians to Paul in chapter 2. Chapter 2, verse 25. Paul says, I think it's necessary to send back to you Epaphroditus, my brother, co-worker, and fellow soldier, who is also your messenger, whom you sent to take care of my needs. Epaphroditus was a member of the church at Philippi. And the church had sent Epaphroditus to where Paul was to help him in his work, to take care of his needs. Now, we don't know exactly what Paul's needs were, but we know how much Paul appreciated Epaphroditus coming, because he describes him as a brother, a co-worker, a fellow soldier. Epaphroditus was a representative of the Philippian church who went there and helped Paul do his work. He provided practical support. And so this is another way that the church partnered in their work. They supported him practically. What's that going to look like for you? Back in Paul's day, it meant sending somebody. Now, maybe that's one way. You might send Omar. Omar, go and visit. Omar would like that. Omar, go and visit Mikey and Lil and pray for them and encourage them, support them in their work. Or maybe somebody else from the church can go as a representative to encourage them. Or maybe it's just by sending them Tim Tams or Vegemite, or I don't know, you ask Mikey and Lil something they might be missing when they're away. Or ask the kids, Raffy, what's your favourite food? He'll think about it, get back to you. Maybe you could send it to him. Or send a birthday card or a gift. Or maybe there's something back here that needs to be done. Maybe some relatives that need to be visited or cared for. There's so many ways that you can practically help people who are living away from home. But you can't do it unless you ask them, how can I support you? How can I help you in your work? What can I do? And you'll be amazed at the different little jobs. Maybe you can help edit fancy videos for them, or print out prayer letters, or who knows. But as we do these things, we are practically caring for them. One of the best ways is just to stay in touch with them. Talk to them on Skype or Zoom or whatever your favourite chat platform is. Hear how they're going. Stay in touch. Because as we do these things, we are joining in the work. So that's a third way. We speak the message, we pray, we provide practical support. And the last one is financial support, money. Now, this was something that the Philippians did for Paul too. It's in chapter 4. He says, as you Philippians know, in the early days of your acquaintance with the gospel, when I set out from Macedonia, not one church shared with me in the matter of giving and receiving except you only. For even when I was in Thessalonica, you sent me aid more than once when I was in need. And then he goes on a little bit later. He says, I'm amply supplied now that I have received from Epaphroditus the gifts you sent. They are a fragrant offering, an acceptable sacrifice, pleasing to God. Paul says that the Philippians had a long history of supporting him with money after he left the church in Philippi. Many times they sent money to support him in his work. It was another way that they could partner in the gospel work. And this is an important reminder for us about the importance of financial support. Now, you might not have lots of money you can support them with, but that's okay. Every bit helps. And Mikey and Lil need to be supported to do the work that they're doing. We want to be generous with everything that God has given us. Think about how can we be involved. It might just be a small gift, but it's another expression of the fact that we're standing with them. We're joining with them in the task of seeing this message go. The thing that I find most exciting about this little passage is the way that Paul describes the gift. Right at the end of verse 18, he says, these gifts are a fragrant offering, an acceptable sacrifice pleasing to God. See, the way Paul talks about this money shows that he doesn't think about it just like a payment. It's not just me giving money to Mikey and Lil. He's actually using the language straight out of the Old Testament that was used to talk about sacrifices in the temple. So Paul's saying, in the Old Testament, if you wanted to worship God, you would take an animal and you would sacrifice it at the temple. That was your act of worship. But in the New Testament, in the New Covenant, one of the ways that we worship God is by giving money to people who are taking his message overseas. It's an act of worship to God. In many ways, you're not giving money to Mikey and Lil. You're giving money to God. You're giving all that you have to God. It's an expression of our worship. It's a way that we show our thankfulness to God for the salvation he has given us, is that we want to see this salvation go to more and more people. So when you send money, think of it as worship. Give thanks to God that he enables you to be a part of his amazing work, bringing more and more people to know him. There are so many ways we can partner. We speak to people about Jesus, we pray, we support people practically, we support people financially. In all these ways, we are just as much a part of God's mission as Mikey and Lil, and all the other people who you support, Pete and Catherine McCarthy, good friends of mine from when they were at college, people who you know and love. This is the way that we partner, because mission is not just something for the experts. It's something for all of us. It's helpful to think of it, I think, just in terms of sport. Sometimes we think mission is like golf. Have you ever seen golf on the television? It's not very exciting, but there's one person who's out there and they hit the ball and there's just crowds of people standing around the outside, right? One person doing all the work. And when they hit a good ball, everybody does, oh, no, it's back, it's very good. Mission's not like that. Mission is more like everybody in game of soccer. You have everybody on the field and everybody has different tasks. Some people are up kicking the goals. Other people are back the other end defending the goals and pushing the ball up more. We are all on the field. We all have a role to play. But we're all working towards the same goal of seeing people hear the wonderful news of Jesus. So, Mikey, Lil, we love you. We're excited to see you going. I think many sad to see you going too. But we're excited at the privilege of being able to be a part of your work, God's work, which you will be doing as you go. Let me pray for us all. Heavenly Father, thank you for the wonderful joy of being a part of your work in the world. Lord, we continue to pray for Mikey and Lil and Rafa and Max and Zelda. We ask for your blessing on them. Use us all, Lord, together so that many more people might hear the wonderful news of Jesus. In his name we pray. Amen.
Let's pray together. Thank you, God, for your message today, once again. How Paul, though he was in prison, was in partnership with his friends in Philippi. As they continue to learn and share the good news about Jesus and the life-saving message to the people. We praise you, Lord God, for Paul's letters from today's message, that even in hard times, we can continue to keep praying to you and trusting in you to keep supporting each other in our walk with you, to share, to learn, and grow in the kingdom of God. We continue to pray to you, God, that for us to keep trusting in you by praying and supporting one another, to keep our eyes fixed on Jesus and not to be moved by the way of this world. For Mike and Lil's family, may your love grow more and more in the knowledge and depth of wisdom for those who don't know Jesus, so that you may be able to work out what is best and may be true and for the day of Christ, filled with God's wisdom and character that comes from Jesus Christ, to the glory and praise of our God. In the name of Jesus, amen.
Before we have morning tea, we're going to finish by saying these words of blessing to one another. So if you're standing at least a metre and a half apart, if you can, try and look at the screen with one eye and maybe at the other person with the other eye. I know that sounds a bit weird, but if you can, also if you can really emphasise the word you, okay? So I really would like you to emphasise the word you. So let's bless each other. These are words from the Old Testament, great words of blessing together. The Lord bless you and protect you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look straight at you and give you peace. Amen. Enjoy your morning tea.